on the ridged plain, a distinctive pattern neatly laid out.
And should be in the brig. But Miss Doyle here has done what we could not do. Let her be captain now. Captain in name, perhaps, but not in practice. I was too aware of all I had yet to learn for that. Besides, as Zachariah would acknowledge later, the fact that I was the daughter of an officer in the company that owned the Seahawk was no small factor in my formal elevation. It will preserve the niceties. But though I was entered into the log as captain, I wrote it there myself, it was Zachariah who took true command. I insisted, and no one objected. The crew chose their mates, Fisk and Barlow, and assembled themselves into two watches, and managed well enough. Johnson was more than happy to return to the forecastle. Regarding Captain Jaggery, the log read simply. At the crew's urging, I wrote that our noble captain had kept his post at the wheel during the hurricane.
And will obey the laws
of the United States
and of the state of Maine.
That I will,
in all respects,
observe the provisions
of the charter and ordinances
of the town of Cape Elizabeth
and statutes of the state of Maine
and will faithfully discharge
the duties of the office
of school board.
And now we'll have the roll call by the town clerk.
Chairman Cogsell?
Here.
Councilor Amaral?
Here.
Councilor Chapel?
Here.
Councilor Creelman?
Here.
Councilor Jordan?
Yeah.
Councilor McLaughlin?
Here.
And Councilor Pearson?
Here.
The minutes of meeting number 1790-91 held May 13th. Do we have a motion to approve them as presented?
So moved.
So moved. Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? Opposed?
Madam Chairman, if I may, I think we forgot to salute the flag.
Do we have that on our agenda this evening? We can. Would you like to do that now?
Yes.
Before the motion. You'll all join us in saluting the flag. I pledge
allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item number one is to consider the election of a town council chairman and take any necessary action.
Madam Chairman.
Councilor Amaral.
It gives me a great deal of pleasure to nominate as the new chairman of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council our very successful finance chair this past year, a person who's just been reelected for his second term to the council, and a person whom I know will do an excellent job and has big shoes to fill following the chairmanship of Chair Cogsell this year. And with that, I am very pleased to nominate Wayne Creelman as the new chair of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimously elected, Mr. Creelman. I just want to, before I turn over my chair, just to thank all my fellow councilors for the support that they have given me during this past year. We've had very many unexpected and unusual controversies, but I think that they were all resolved for the best of the town. And I also want to thank Town Manager Michael McGovern and Town Clerk Deborah Pisa for all their assistance. I very happily turn this over to you, Mr. Crowman.
Well, this is one of the few opportunities in life you get to offer a few remarks, and I'd like to do that concerning our upcoming year. I thank the citizens and my fellow councilors for the opportunity to chair the council and provide leadership in this very difficult economic time. Municipal officials nationally are trying to save money and cut budgets by finding more economical ways of delivering the many existing services that we currently provide our citizens. In the future, the levels of some of these services may possibly need to be reduced, or the hiring of outside firms may need to take place, where cost effectiveness and morale consideration issues would lend support in that direction. I'm hopeful that the council can work with the town manager over the next year to implement a flexible benefit plan, or cafeteria plan as we know it, in lieu of the current fixed plan available for municipal employees. This year's total budget, which includes municipal and county services, is approximately 7% less than last fiscal year's budget. My sense is that for the next year, significant cuts are inevitable. Currently, the state of Maine faces a $1.2 billion budget shortfall for the 2 years beginning July 1, 1991. We are already keenly aware that there will be less money for local schools that have come through the general purpose aid to education, and many of you are also aware of the current proposal to freeze state aid to education. The issue of class size, salaries, and programs will continue to need to be scrutinized by our colleagues on the school board. This is a time where we will have to do better rather than settling for doing less. Obviously, this means that increased efficiency will have to take place. The whole idea of privatization will have to be explored. The issue of hiring others to provide municipal, school, or county services, and certainly looking at this issue with respect to the possibility of private contractors running state prisons and possibly jails, will need to be assessed. The balance between what system best offers the provision of services and department morale will consistently need to be looked at. The whole issue of looking at county government with respect to regionalizing duplicate municipal services also cannot be ignored. The possibility of transferring county government responsibilities to either state or local municipalities will have to be considered. These are the realities, and we cannot hide from them. I look forward to the many events planned over the next year also. I look forward to the Public Works Garage addition becoming a reality. Certainly Bob Malley and his department are well deserving of this structural improvement in their work quarters. I look forward to the opening of the museum at Portland Headlight. This will be an extraordinary event where many individuals' tireless efforts will culminate in a great center of community pride. I look forward to the utilization of 1226 Shore Road for easing of congestion in Town Hall, allowing for municipal meetings to take place, community services activities to occur, and senior citizen programs to flourish. I also hope we can find a better name for this building than 1226 Shore Road. I look forward to starting the process of establishing a town center planning committee this evening, while also all through the year implementing features of the comprehensive plan. The ordinance committee will be busy with fine-tuning an affordable housing ordinance as well as a shoreland zoning ordinance. I also hope that the Board of Health might be able to take a look at the town and school-wide issues of drug and alcohol abuse, and possibly offer input with respect to substance abuse policies, both at the employer as well as school level. I hope also that the issue of AIDS prevention can be looked at in greater detail by the Board of Health and issues disseminated by the Board to the citizens. A specific recommendation that I'm going to make is that when we typically see the category of municipal meetings every Monday morning in the Portland Press Herald, that rather than just having the Cape Elizabeth Town Council meeting at 7:30, that we also include an agenda for the evening so that citizens can be clear when public hearings are being held, and a decision to list specific items on the agenda that are of a greater importance than some of the items that we deal with on a monthly basis. I'd like to see this become a reality. Lastly, I want to remind everyone that the countdown has begun for the legislature to vote in Augusta on legal document 66, LD 66. This is the constitutional amendment to prohibit the state from passing unfunded mandates. In the remaining days before the vote on LD 66, we need all of our citizens to do the following immediately. Contact our state representative, Steve Simons. He can be reached at 1-800-423-2900. And Senator Barbara Gill, she can be reached at 1-800-423-6900. Contact them about the importance of passing LD 66. The only way this bill will pass is if lots of people contact their lawmakers and tell them how important it is to them. The people of Maine deserve a chance to vote on this very important issue, and it will only happen if the legislature allows LD 66 to go out to a referendum vote in November. With those remarks, I will conclude and thank you very much. At this point, I'm going to go down to the podium. I'm going to ask our immediate past chairman to join me here. Phyllis, on behalf of the town council last year, you have presented multiple proclamations, resolutions, and awards to Cape Elizabeth's athletic team champions, committee members, particular citizens for special recognition, and last but not least, to past board chairpersons. During your year of leadership, the council has increased recycling, enacted a bond for our municipal public works garage addition, formed a committee to plan for school space needs, guided the Portland Headlight Museum efforts with a planned opening this year, encouraged citizen vote on our now 7-member school board, enhanced training for municipal board members, adopted a new sign ordinance, acquired 1226 Shore Road in the town center, implemented most of Main Street 90 improvements, developed the War Veterans Memorial, which was dedicated recently on Memorial Day, and avoided lawsuits. The many other accomplishments are simply too numerous to mention. We all extend our thanks for the extra time and energy you devoted to chairing the council, and very much look forward to your guidance and our continued work together. And in behalf of the council, we would like to present you with this plaque. On the plaque is emblazoned Town of Cape Elizabeth, Phyllis C. Coggeshall, Town Council Chairman, 1991. Thank you very much. As long as I'm here, I'm not going to go back yet. Rosemary Reed, would you please come down to the podium?
Very good.
I don't have a prepared speech. Phyllis has took me about 2 hours, so this is entirely ad lib. It's been my impression over the last several years that when you hear about the Cape Elizabeth School Department or any of the activities, Rosemary Reed is somewhere in the middle of the story. This proved true right to yesterday as I was watching the Pirates of Penzance and only opened the program to find Rosemary Reed, who had worked extraordinarily hard soliciting much support for this particular production. This is one of many of the tireless efforts that Rosemary has given to the town over the last year in her public service on the town council. One of the hallmarks of Rosemary's one-year term on the town council was characterized, I think, by the fact that she always did her homework. She was always prepared with respect to any issue we dealt with, and we are very grateful and appreciative of that year that you served with us. And for that, I would like to present you this plaque. On it is Town of Cape Elizabeth, Rosemary Reed, Town Council 1990 to 1991. Thank you very much. Is Ian Gray here? Please come down. Between 1990 and 1991, Ann F. Gray gave tirelessly with respect to chairing the Board of Sewer Appeals. This is not the most glamorous or sexy committee in the town. Nonetheless, we are grateful for your help and service. And for that, we have, again, a chairman's plaque. Thank you very much. Is Polly Morrison here? I saw Polly earlier. Between 1988 and 1991, major commitment, Polly has added extraordinary vitality to the Arts Commission as chairperson. We're all aware of the Portland String Quartet, the variety of events that take place during the year with our Arts Commission. I enjoy personally the Mardi Gras festival at the library not too long ago. Polly, we thank you very much for your service on the Arts Commission, and I'm delighted to present you with this chairman's plaque. Thank you very much. Ivan Most. Ivan co-chaired the planning board 1990 to 1991. If you think town councilors get telephone calls and receive heat once in a while, the planning board certainly gets its fair share and provides a very effective shield for us on many occasions. We very much appreciate your efforts co-chairing the committee. On behalf of the town council, I'm delighted to present you the chairman's plaque. Thank you. Thank you all. Is Dick Tinsman here tonight? Richard Tinsman, I know he has a number of Coast Guard responsibilities in Washington. Is there anyone here in his behalf? What I will do is we will present Richard at a later date his co-chairman gavel for his work on the planning board and also the chairman's gavel for his chairmanship on the Main Street 90 committee. And we're very, very appreciative of his extraordinary work and dedication to the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. William Wadman. Bill chaired our Conservation Commission 1990 to 1991. As you all are very aware, one of the big issues in Cape Elizabeth is involving land use They're complicated issues. They're technical issues. And Bill has provided excellent leadership and service to the town as chairman of the commission. And I'm delighted to present you with the chairman's gavel. Thank you very much. Is Jeff Shedd here somewhere? Jeffrey Shedd? No. Again, we will provide Jeffrey with the chairman's plaque for the Thomas Memorial Library Trustees Chairmanship, which he held from 1990 to 1991. We're all aware of the extraordinary efforts that he has provided the town and are most appreciative of his service also. I don't see Clint Blood. Did Clint sneak in somewhere? I was told he was going to be umpiring a game and probably not here till a little later, so I will just pass over him for a moment in the hopes that he will arrive at some point and I can provide his plaque out of order with the indulgence of the council. Could we have our newest member and senior advisor, Irving Chappell, down at the podium for a moment? I'm sure everyone in Cape Elizabeth knows Irving Chappell. I stood next to him pretty much most of Election Day, and I can verify that anyone who voted in Cape Elizabeth knows Irving Chappell. If they weren't former scouts under his tutelage, they married sisters of former scouts that Irv had formed over the years. It was truly a very moving experience to stand with Irv on Election Day. Irving, over the last year, chaired the Municipal Facilities Committee. These are very, very difficult times. This was an extremely difficult task. We, at the very end, when they thought they were done, threw them 1226 Shore Road to also help out with in terms of defining the uses of this new property in the town center. Irving was also Grand Marshal of our recent Memorial Day Parade. The list goes on. I'm here specifically to give Irv the gavel for his chairmanship on municipal facilities. We very much appreciate your service. James Cox?
Not everyone goes in the council and get a plaque the first day.
For those of you who were at the dedication of the War Veterans Recognition Plaque, James Cox has been instrumental in bringing this project to a completion. It was certainly very moving for all of us on Memorial Day to see the list of individuals who gave their lives in the service of our country who resided in Cape Elizabeth. This was a large task. There were many meetings. And we're most appreciative, Jim, of your work in chairing the War Veterans Recognition Committee. In that behalf, I'm pleased to present you the gavel and plaque of chairman. Thank you. Thank you. I think I have to go back to work. I appreciate the indulgence of my fellow councilors. I did take the presentation of plaques to past board chairmen out of order. I would now like to offer an opportunity for citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda this evening. Is there anyone in the audience that would like to address any particular issues? Please, would you just come to the podium, tell us your name and your address, please.
Chairman Creelman and members of the town council, my name is Bill Britton. I reside at 206 Two Lights Road in Cape Elizabeth. I reside three houses down from the Coast Guard, and directly across the street from what is known as the Lobster Shack and the Candle Shack. I filed a zoning complaint with the code enforcement officer, Ernie McVane, and I've sent most of you a copy of my complaint against both Mr. James Ledbetter, the owner and operator of the Candle Shack, and Herb Porch, the owner and operator of the Lobster Shack. And this evening I would like to ask the town council to request that the town manager, Michael McGovern, examine and investigate what the code enforcement officer and the Zoning Board of Appeals has done since 1980, when the then building inspector, Gerald Daigle, wrote to Mr. Herb Porch, the owner of the Lobster Shack, and Mr. Jerry Daigle, and Mr. James Ledbetter, the owner of the Candle Shack, that they should not be using the so-called Piper parcel as a parking lot. This was a letter and a determination made by the code enforcement officer that this particular parcel was a non-conforming use in a residential area. And I've come here to this council this evening to request that Michael McGovern, as the town manager, examine and report back to the town council on what type of enforcement actions the code enforcement officer and the Zoning Board of Appeals has done to enforce the zoning ordinances of the town of Cape Elizabeth. I make this request because 2 years ago, even after the town, through Jerry Daigle, had informed Mr. Ledbetter not to use the Piper parcel as a parking lot, he proceeded to put parking curbs and, on a fairly regular basis, has been directing traffic into the Piper parcel for parking of both the Candle Shack and the Lobster Shack. I'd also ask that the town manager examine and investigate the use of the subsurface waste disposal system that's underneath the Piper parcel. My understanding is that there's a license agreement recorded at the Registry of Deeds that between Mr. Ledbetter and Mr. Porch, who happen to be related by marriage, that subsurface waste disposal system be used to provide waste disposal to the Lobster Shack, a non-conforming grandfather use. My understanding of the zoning ordinance would be that this would be an extension of a non-conforming use to an adjacent residential parcel, and I don't know that whether this has been appropriately addressed by the code enforcement officer or the Zoning Board of Appeals, and I ask that Michael McGovern report back to this town council on what enforcement actions have been taken, and if none, what actions will be taken in the future. Thank you.
Mr. Britton, you might just want to stay at the podium for a moment. I know I received both your May 17th and May 24th correspondence. Am I assuming correctly that all the counselors also received the two documents in question? Are there any questions for Mr. Britton? He's made a request to the town manager. Is that feasible to look into these particular matters? I know this is an issue specifically for the Zoning Board of Appeals. Do you have any particular, anything to add?
Yeah, this in all likelihood will be on the agenda of the Zoning Board of Appeals later this month. What I'd like to do is, following that meeting, perhaps look back at the record, and then I will provide Mr. Britton a report such as he's indicated, and I'd be happy to provide a copy of that to the council as well.
Just a follow-up to that, my understanding was that there was a written determination made back in 1980 that was a residential lot. Both Mr. Porch and Mr. Ledbetter had a reasonable period of time in which to appeal that. I believe that they are barred by the statute of limitations from bringing this matter before the Zoning Board. I believe also that there's a case down in Kennebunkport known as the Shackford and Gooch case, which says that the town cannot be stopped from enforcing its zoning ordinance. So I think that the statute of limitations will stop Mr. Ledbetter and Mr. Porch from using that to extend the operations of either the Candle Shack or the Lobster Shack. And I would like that the town council assist Mike McGovern and the code enforcement officer, now Ernie McVane, to take the appropriate actions to enforce its zoning ordinance.
Mr. Britton, you can rest assured that we will have Mr. McVeigh and our town manager look into this particular matter.
Thank you.
I'm going to beg the pardon again and move right back down to the podium for a moment. I see someone has just come in. Clint, I don't want you to wait. I don't know if you've got another inning to umpire. Or are you done for the evening? All right. Well, keep your distance. No, I just want to make sure I have the right dates here. People do things for 1 year or 2 years. See, I would have had it wrong if I didn't get my paper. For 2 years, Clinton Blood has chaired the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. As you all know, lots of things are happening at Fort Williams. We recently accepted a master plan, and as you remember in my earlier remarks this evening, the museum at Portland Headlight hopefully will become a reality in the very near future. In behalf of the town council, I would like to present you, Clint, with the chairman's gavel for the years 1989 to 1991 with our thanks. Let me return now to any other citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Seeing none, I will close this portion of the meeting this evening. With respect to reports and correspondence, I've already alluded to the two letters that Mr. Britton has sent to the town council. I also should acknowledge a thank you for our thank you, Dick O'Donnell. In true Dick O'Donnell fashion, after we bestowed upon him the Ralph Gould Award, he then thanked us for that thank you, so we are going to acknowledge and thank him for his thank you. And lastly, we also received a letter since our last meeting from Jeffrey White, the chairman of the School Space Study Committee. My understanding is that this committee is looking for an extension, and we will plan on adding this particular item to the end of the meeting so that everyone can be thinking about this letter throughout the meeting. We'll add it as item 27, I believe. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. Item 27 at the end of the meeting. That was the extent of correspondence that the chairman received. Other reports and correspondence.
I just want to report that at the last meeting of the jail committee, which I'm a member of, that things are progressing and the land has been obtained and they're ready to do their little bit of the groundwork and they're in fire edge. Construction bidding and the bids will be out and ready to go, they're hopefully by September or October, but it might not make that target date, but that's what they're shooting for so they can get going on the facility.
Other reports, Janet.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Although I did not attend last month's COG General Assembly meeting, I have touched base with them, and rather than rather than have an executive committee meeting in June, they will be having General Assembly. I know we have members of this council who later this evening will be appointed to that, and the COG General Assembly meeting will be next Thursday, June 20th. What I've heard today is that it will be Wyndham Town Hall, starting at 4:30. And that's, I'm sure more information will be forthcoming in the mail. Thank you.
Councilor Amaral.
Thank you, Chair. I've had either the very fortunate good luck or the very unfortunate bad luck to be appointed to the Special Commission to Restructure State Government in the state of Maine. And as a member of that commission, I would ask any of my fellow town councilors or anybody in the community who have any good ideas, maybe they're not good, at least creative ideas, on how we might restructure state government to make it run more efficiently and to cost us all less money, I'd really appreciate hearing from you. And I ask you that with a real honest plea, because we need all the advice we can get. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Yes.
Indeed, congratulations. Any other reports or correspondence? Seeing none, we will close that portion of the council meeting. We will now take item number 2 to consider a proposed amendment to the rules of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council relating to reconsiderations and take any necessary action. And I will ask Councilor McLaughlin to present this particular item.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want you to know how deeply Town Clerk Deborah Pizzo and I have been delving into Robert's rules, and we thought we were going to die in there for a while today, but I think we've come to surface. And you should have received this evening a one-page memo from me, thanks to Mrs. Pizzo, concerning amending the language that was in the packets we received last week. The reconsideration rule deals with the criteria for requesting the reconsideration of vote after a vote is taken if there is very good reason to want to put that to vote again. This is the rule that enables us to do so. I have found for the past years I've been on council that this rule has been a bit distressing to me. It has not been in conformance with Robert's rules, and felt that this was as an appropriate time as any to propose a change to it. The first change I would make proposed is the very first phrase of the section, which now says when a vote is passed. I think we would be more explicit and accurate to say after a vote is taken, because you can have a reconsideration of a vote that did not pass if it was, for example, a tie vote. Tie votes bring us to part of the existing language that I have found bothersome. The way it is stated right now, any member who votes in what results in a tie vote may ask for a reconsideration. Robert's rules give some very good language and explanations of why you should have a person in the majority requesting a reconsideration. The majority in a tie, on the prevailing side, I'm going to do this. This has been so bad today. You want somebody on the prevailing side to be able to request a reconsideration. The prevailing side on a tie vote is the side that votes against the motion, according to Robert's rules. We have had instances of tie votes on this council. It's very difficult to make 100% of the council meetings, and sometimes, even if we are here, we have to step down because of conflict of interest. So we have had certainly occasions where we have only 6 members voting. Robert's rules states that the purpose of reconsidering a vote is to permit correction of hasty, ill-advised, or erroneous action, or to take into account added information or a changed situation that has developed since the taking of the vote. One thing I will always say to the constituents is, I make my vote based on the best information I have at a given time. If new information is brought to light, I certainly would like to be able to have a reconsideration called, for instance, in a tie vote, no matter which side I'm on. That's why it's Debbie's amendment also, to strike the words in the majority and have Section 18 read, after a vote is taken, it shall be in order for any member who voted on the prevailing side of a vote to have a reconsideration thereof at the same or next stated meeting, but not afterwards. And when a motion of reconsideration is decided, that vote shall not be reconsidered. I think the time frames in here will help us do our job very reasonably. If you wanted to reconsider a vote ad infinitum, we would have our hands tied in a lot of issues and could not progress the way we need to. So I don't see any problem with the rest of the language other than what I am proposing this evening. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Let me just scan the audience to see if there's any particular confusion or questions or input from the audience on this item. If not, I'd like to take a motion at this particular time so we can offer discussion.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we approve the amended Section 18 as read this evening.
May I have a second?
Second.
Okay, now we can have some discussion on the item.
I just feel, excuse me, Mr. Chairman. I feel that the Robert's Rules of Order have been around for centuries and have evolved to meet any necessary changes, and that we refer to the Robert's Rules of Order as being the rules we'll follow except for any particular changes that are in our own rules. And since that is a tried and true procedure for tie votes, I feel that we should incorporate into ours.
Any other input from the council on item two? Councilor Amler.
I didn't think that we should have changed Robert's rules the last time around, so I'm very much in favor of this amendment to go back to following the same procedure as recommended in Robert's Rules of Order.
Further input? I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of item two, as stated by Councilor McLaughlin. Raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Item number three, to consider a proposed amendment to the rules of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council relating to preparation of town council agendas and take any necessary action. I will ask Councilor Coggeshall to present item three.
Yes, under Section 33, it now presently states that the town manager shall prepare the agenda, which shall include the order of business for council meetings under the direction of the council. The agenda shall be distributed to the members of the council and made available to the public by Wednesday preceding the date of the regular council meeting and at least 24 hours before a time set for other meetings. There have been times in the past when we as councilors have sort of given direction to the manager to include items on the agenda or a particular, perhaps, order. And for various reasons, which is very rare, these have not been included or included in that particular order. So I just feel that it should be amended to read that the town manager and the chairman of the council would prepare the agenda. I feel that the town council, and particularly the town council chairman, as the representative of the town council and representing the citizens of the town of Cape Elizabeth, should have more supervisory power in preparing the town council agenda. In the past, as I said, we have had instances when items have been excluded, and I might also just point out the most recent one, which was this evening, when the salute to the flag wasn't included on the agenda. So I feel that it would not be a more complicated procedure to follow since the town council chairman and the town manager are in contact, if not daily, at least twice a week, to set up a reasonable time to review it, not necessarily have to sit down there and go over item by item. But Michael could prepare, or the manager could prepare, the agenda as he has in the past and just run it by before it's finalized.
Thank you.
Therefore, I move that we amend Section 33 to include and the town, and the chairman of the town council shall prepare the agenda.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Okay, some discussion. I would be particularly interested in former chairman of the council, Councilor Jordan and Councilor Amaroff, if you might be willing to offer an opinion on this particular change.
I was going to yield to the lady. No, I don't think this is necessary. I feel that the manager is capable of putting the agenda together, and I don't see why he has to run by the chairman of the council. And I feel he's capable of doing all of that. He omitted something this evening that's quite close to me, but I'll forgive him for that. But I'm not in favor of the change, I'll put it this way, because I support the manager. If he can't put the agenda together satisfactorily, maybe we better have a new manager.
I guess I'd like to offer a differing opinion, because I think that certainly the manager is capable of putting the agenda together, but I think it ought to be a draft agenda, and that the chairman ought to have input into any new items or different items, or certainly the order on that agenda. In fact, almost any committee that I have served on, whether it be the executive director or even at the state level, the commissioner, the chairman of the elected or lay board always has the ability to help set the agenda, and I think that's a very good way of operating. But certainly I would think the process would remain, as Phyllis has said, pretty much the same way, that the manager would put together an agenda, pass it by the chairman of the council for any additions, deletions, or changes in order, and that I think that's a very good way to operate. It has worked on several other groups that I have been part of. So I'm very much in favor of this change.
Having heard from past chairmen, I'd be delighted to hear other input.
Mr. Chairman, I think I'd be happier with it if said the town manager, with the advice and consent of the chairman of the council, shall prepare the agenda, rather than making it definite that the town manager and the chairman of the council. I think advice and consent might take care of everything. In other words, it could be over the phone, it could be, they wouldn't have to get together to prepare it. I think when you say, and the chairman of the council, that you're meaning that the two of them are going to meet and go over this agenda and prepare it, I don't think that's necessary.
I'm not really interpreting it that way, Irv. I'm assuming that and the chairman of the council does mean that that discussion can take place on the phone if necessary under given circumstances, and that a formal face-to-face meeting would not be required in both of those individuals preparing the agenda. Phyllis, you proposed the change. What was your feeling about that?
My feeling was that it was, as a lot of things are discussed now over the phone with the manager, that if you felt it was necessary to have a meeting, you could set up a meeting, but that it was not mandatory that you met face-to-face. With the advice and consent makes it seem a little more lenient than the and, but I don't see where it's that demanding. The and is not that demanding.
Mm-hmm. Irv, did you make an amendment?
No, just a comment.
Okay, thank you. That makes it a little easier. Councilor Jordan.
I would like to, I think what Councilor Chappell brought up is very, very good, and I think it leaves it a little more lenient than the way it is worded now, and if I would wish he would put that in a form of amendment.
Councilor Chappell, would you like to put that in the form of an amendment?
At the request of my good friend, Councilor Jordan, I will put that into an amendment that it read that the town manager, with the advice and consent of the chairman of the council, shall prepare the agenda.
Do I have a second?
Second. I'm sorry. I want to explain, guys.
I believe it would be proper at this point to get a vote on the amendment. All those in favor of the amendment? It looks like a 5-2 vote.
Aye.
I'm sorry.
I'm seeing a
quizzical look over there.
I did not vote in favor. Carl, did you vote in favor?
I did.
You did. It's a 6-1 vote on the amendment. Now we can return to discussion on the motion itself, I believe.
So the motion now reads, the town manager and the chairman of the town council, the town manager with the advice and consent of, is that right?
I would move the item as amended.
Second it.
Okay, I'll call for a vote on item 3 as amended. All those in favor? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It looks like a 7-0 vote. Unanimous vote. Thank you very much. Item number 4, to consider adoption of the rules of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council with any approved amendments, and we will take any necessary action. We have 2 unanimous changes to the rules. We all have the rules before us. All 6 pages of my rules, although I saw a... We're missing some pages on the copy of rules that were passed out early this evening. I have an old copy that I brought with me, but we are missing page 5 and 6, I believe. It the council rules continues on through section 30 through 34, and we only received through section 29. Be that as it may, I will ask for a motion on item 4 at this time. Councilor Amaral.
I will move that the council adopt the rules as amended this evening for operating the business of the town council of Cape Elizabeth.
Second.
Thank you. Discussion. All those in favor, raise your right hand. It is unanimous.
I had my left hand up
a little bit.
I counted it nonetheless. Item number 5 is to consider the appointment of a finance committee and to take any necessary action. May I hear a motion?
Mr. Counselor. Chairman, it gives me great pleasure to nominate the previous chairman of the Ordinance Committee, who's done an outstanding job this year, Councilor Janet McLaughlin, as chairman of the Committee of the Whole, which is the Finance Committee.
A second?
Second motion.
Thank you. Any discussion? I'll take a vote in favor. It's unanimous. Item number 6, to consider the appointment of an Ordinance Committee and take any necessary action. Do I hear a motion? Someone of the councilors has a little card in front of him or her that says item 6, Ordinance Committee.
Oh, is that what this is?
Yeah. Councilor Chapel, you have you're going to move a motion here.
I was wondering what this card was. I move that the Ordinance Committee chairman for the coming year be Phyllis Gongshaw, and the 2 members be William Jordan and Janet McLaughlin.
Second.
All those in favor of item 6? Unanimous. Item number 7, to consider the appointment of an appointments committee and take any necessary action. Councilor McLaughlin.
Mr. Chairman, it's with great pleasure, since I've had 2 years of service on the appointments committee, to make this recommendation to the council. And I see that our seating arrangement is similar to what it was last year, in that we have the Ordinance Committee on one side, and folks I'm going to appoint to Appointments Committee over on the other side. I'm not sure, I don't know if that's purposeful or not. But I would like to recommend that we appoint Councillor Carl Pearson as chairman of the Appointments Committee. I wish you well in that. And the members to be Councillor Jane Amaro and Councillor Irving Chapel.
I'll second.
Thank you. All those in favor? It's unanimous. Item number 8, to consider the election of of representatives to serve on the Greater Portland Council of Governments Executive Committee and take any necessary action. I believe that also includes two members on the General Assembly also for item 8.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to nominate to the COG Executive Committee Councilor Janet McLaughlin, and to the COG General Assembly Councilor Irvin Chappell, and yourself, Councilor Krailman. And as an alternate to both groups, I'd like to suggest that Manager Michael McGovern fill the slots if anyone of the previous could not attend.
Second motion.
All those in favor? Thank you very much. Unanimous. Item number 9, to consider the appointment of a council representative to serve on the Regional Waste Systems Board of Directors and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Jordan.
I would like, first of all, commend our previous rep on RWS, Lester Jordan, which I feel has done a tremendous job, and he's served on that for a good number of years. And as he told me, he's the old-timer there now, and there's a lot of new blood, and he says, and I get lost in the thinking. But he said, well, he isn't present here at the meetings and what have you. He feels that it would be advisable if we had a new member. And therefore, I will give this honor to a well-known Cape Elizabeth resident and a new counselor, Irv Chappell, as a representative to RWS, and his helper or an alternate, Kyle Pearson, Councilor Pearson.
I'll second.
All those in favor? It is again unanimous.
Lester, it took two to do your job.
Item number 10, to consider an appointment to the PACS Policy Committee and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman.
Counselor.
I'd like to nominate Town Manager Michael McGovern to serve once again. I don't know how many years he's been serving on the PACS Policy Committee, but this is the committee that deals with transportation issues in the region, and I hope that he won't work too hard on getting traffic lights for Cape Elizabeth while he serves on this committee. But I am willing to nominate him to the committee.
Second.
Nonetheless.
Second the motion.
All those in favor? It is again unanimous.
I like your comments, Councilor Amaral.
With the stipulation about the traffic.
Item number 11 is to consider a proposed amendment to the sign ordinance clarifying the size limit of signs and take any necessary action. I will now ask the former chair of the ordinance committee, Councilor McLaughlin, to present the amendment, and then I shall open a public hearing.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The ordinance committee has reviewed a proposed amendment to our fairly new sign ordinance. Deep in amendments tonight. This was basically brought to our attention by the town planner, and I thank her for doing so. The proposed amendment would be in section 21.2.3, which we got to know as the page of the charts, which gave the different criteria, dimensional criteria, for different types of signs. The proposed amendment reads, unless specifically designated, all sign types in the town shall be limited to the size restrictions in section 21.1.3 sub A. Proposed signs shall be assigned the most applicable sign type category by the code enforcement officer. What this proposed amendment does basically is to refine the existing ordinance to ensure that we have consistent regulation for the size of allowed signs within the zones. There are a good number of signs that are specifically governed by other sections of the ordinance that would not come under this. Some of those are garage sale signs, real estate signs, pick your own produce signs, home occupation signs. But unless a sign type is specifically referenced in another part of the ordinance as to its allowed dimensions, it would come under the dimensions on the page with the chart. And what we would propose to do is to have this set to public hearing next month. Do you want that in the form of a no?
Not yet. I'm going to open a public hearing on it first.
We're doing public hearing now. I'm sorry. Just a month.
Thank you, Counselor. With that presentation, I will now open the public hearing on the proposed amendment to the sign ordinance. Is there input from any of the individuals in our audience this evening? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and ask for a motion on item 11.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we approve the proposed amendment to the sign ordinance for section 21.2.3, permitted signs in the BA, BB, and BC zones, a new subsection sub C.
Can I have a second? Second. Thank you very much. Discussion, please. Hearing none, all those in favor of item 11? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Item 12 is to consider a request from the New England Telephone Company for conduit locations on Fowler and Old Ocean House roads and take any necessary action. I will now defer to our town manager to discuss this particular item.
Last month, the town council discussed this particular item, and it was tabled. It provides for some new conduit at the intersections of Fowler Road, Old Ocean House Road, and Route 77. I believe there's two gentlemen here from the phone company who wish to provide an overview of the intended project and answer any questions you may have.
Gentlemen, would you be kind enough to come up to the podium, tell us who you are?
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, Mr. McGovern, my name is Blaine Hopkins. I'm manager of right-of-way acquisitions for the New England Telephone for the Southern Maine District. With me tonight, I have Michael Delateski from Ost Associates, who has put together a brief overview of the project as we propose. And if you feel it would be beneficial, I would go through it and explain the entire project.
We'd be delighted.
New England Telephone is proposing to convert the central part of Cape Elizabeth to digital and fiber optic switching. In conjunction with this, we have secured an easement just at the very beginning of the gravel pit entrance to Leland Murray's gravel pit. In that particular area, we're proposing to place a fiber digital switch facility. It's a small building, about 11 feet by 17 feet. And to put it in perspective, if you were to look at the small storage building that is by the track in back of the schools, this building would be about 50 feet from that, just across this entrance drive. What we propose to do is place the building, and then we will serve that building with a piece of fiber optic cable, which eventually would terminate in our Portland switching office. From that building, we would then bury some conduit along this private road, and at this portion, we would enter the town portion, and this is the particular pieces here that we have petitioned you for permission to place, as well as this portion here. Now, this one here would be for our electric service that would go in and serve the building. This would be for the telephone cables that come into the building. Also, we've petitioned you for some additional conduit over here as it goes down Old Ocean House Road. One of the reasons that I'm sure that it was so confusing is by state regulation, we had to petition the municipality for the portion on Fowler Road. We had to petition the state by state statute for that crosses Ocean House Road. And this portion here that ties it all together is a private property easement. So with the advent of this type of system, we will be serving approximately one-third of the subscribers in the town with digital and fiber optic service, which is something that is, it's recent technology. We've been using it perhaps for the last 18 months to 2 years. At this point, I defer to any questions that you may have, and hopefully I can answer them.
I have just two questions to begin the discussion. The first is, how disruptive, if at all, will services be in the context of making these several cuts across the macadam surface?
These two right here would probably be done. The cuts themselves would probably take about an hour. As far as closing off the road wouldn't be closed. As they were digging, they would place metal plates across the road so that traffic would be controlled. Traditionally, what we try to do is, if municipal contracts allow for traffic control, we would employ off-duty municipal police officers to help us control the traffic so that we wouldn't have a problem. The portion that goes across Ocean House Road, which would be the most disruptive, would probably take 3 or 4 hours to put that across there. Now, that is for the initial, for the cutting and the placement of the conduit. Final restoration, the entire scope of this project would probably be about 3 days. But at no time would traffic be disrupted to the point where it would not flow in a normal manner. I wouldn't see a great deal of disruption. What we have done is we have, although we do want to get started with this project, we have delayed starting it until September, hoping that perhaps any summer traffic that might be going to the beaches would be minimized.
Just one other question, and I'm going to ask our Public Works Director if he would like to offer any input before we continue our council discussion. And that is, how exactly are the cuts going to be made? Will these be sawed cuts or
yes,
jackhammered?
They will. No, they'll be sawed cuts. And then as far as the restoration, we would adhere to whatever the municipality would require. And generally, that's after we saw across and do our trenching, we would cut back about 1 foot on either side of the trench. But prior to doing the paving, we would pour a concrete cap, and then we would pave from that.
Just if I may, Mr. Chairman, this is one of three permits that New England Telephone will need to install this particular area. This is the utility location permit. You're, in essence, as the property owner of the road, giving them permission to place the conduit under the road. Secondly, they'll need to approach the Department of Public Works for a street opening permit, and it's at that point that Barb reviews all the technical requirements, and you know they would be as simple as Mr. Hopkins has indicated. The third permit will be for the actual building itself down in what looks in the pit or aside the pit. It's one of three permits.
Mr. Malley, would it be more helpful for you to respond perhaps at the end of our questions or now? Okay, fine. Okay, thank you. Please, Councilor.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. I would like to ask if the cut across Ocean House Road is going to be above the new pavement. It's not going to be cutting into the pavement that was just installed this past year.
No, it isn't. As a matter of fact, it's about 50 feet prior to the new paved portion.
Okay.
Are there other questions from the council? Mr. Malley, you've indicated already you have no particular problems with the proposal. Do any of the councilors have any specific questions for Mr. Malley?
I'd like to backtrack, Mr. Chairman, if I may. Mr. Hopkins, I do have a question. So the only disruption of pavement will be one cut across. Is it going to be one or two cuts across Fowler?
There'll be two cuts. One will be for the electrical service and one will be for the telephone. They'll be relatively close, and so that when we repave, there'll only be one patch to the pavement.
And so we've got two cuts with one patch across Fowler and one cut across Old Ocean House.
One patch. Right.
And the rest of the proposed work is being done within the shoulder areas?
That's right.
On the road?
You can see the underground splice facility, which is a major excavation, takes place outside of the paved portion, as well as the majority of the conduit that goes down Ocean House Road. That too would be in the shouldered area of the road.
Okay. That your explanation this evening greatly enhances my understanding of your project. I did have some of these same questions last month, and I very much appreciate your presentation, your being here this evening. I have had it explained to me by a friend who works for the phone company how advantageous this is going to be to the users in that part of town. And I'm glad to hear that it's minimal road disruption and traffic disruption, and glad to hear that you're planning to start in September. I think that was a concern of all the councilors because of the heavy traffic we experience with Crescent Beach and Two Light State Park being so heavily used during the summer months, and I'm glad you've paid attention to that and can let us know that. I thank you.
You're welcome, and certainly at any point that any of the council members have any questions concerning any of our construction activities, certainly feel free to call upon us as you have in this instance, and we're more than happy to put together a presentation so that you would be able to answer those questions that may be posed to you by constituents.
Are there any other questions or need for clarification from members of the council? Council.
I move that we grant the request from New England Telephone Company for conduit locations in Fowler and Old Ocean House Roads.
Second that.
We have a motion. All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much, Mr. Hopkins.
Thank you.
Item number 13, to consider bid results for expansion of the Public Works garage and take any necessary action. Mr. Manager.
Yes. At the direction of the council several months ago, we solicited bids for the Public Works garage addition and renovations. Right before we went out to bid, we noted that the architect and engineer's estimate was a little bit above, around $20,000 above the $400,000 amount that the council had set aside. Subsequently, we did receive only four bids for the project, but I think four very good bids. The low bidder was submitted by a locker construction company. We subsequently, working very closely with the engineers, reviewed the bids, and as well as with the contractor, and tried to bring down the budget to for the project, or the cost within the budget. In order to do that, a number of items have been eliminated. Chief among them is a fence that's on the outside of the building that we did receive an alternate bid on that was around $20,000, Bob. So quite expensive. Beyond that, there is a list that you received in your supplemental packet on Friday that recommends a number of changes amounting to $12,246. The amount we needed to cut to get within budget was around $10,525. Even with these cuts, we are still leaving within the project a 7% contingency for the construction phase, or $26,425. Bob Malley is here to answer any questions you may have. The architects volunteered to be here. I said in deference to trying to keep this thing within the budget, I didn't think it was necessary for them to attend. But Bob is here, and I am as well, to answer any questions you may have. But I would recommend that you authorize me to sign the contract with Locker Construction.
Mr. Malley, would you be kind enough to come down to the podium so that councilors may be able to ask you for any clarification or questions on this particular awarded bid? Are there questions from the council? Councilor Jordan.
Thank you for the fence, Mr. Manager. On the page here that come out with our council agenda, and it says here, area possible savings. Reduce the amount of full depth paving construction, smooth face blocks instead of split face blocks. Now, is there a figure on any of these? I didn't compare the sheet now, I'll tell you that right now. I didn't get to compare that one from this one. My point here is deleting paddle fan FF5. Substitute a split system on duct central air conditioning. Now, is any of these going to be what we might hear a hazardous or a safety factor later on, that it's bad conditions to be working without these? There are no problems. It was a luxury, as you might say, that was added in there.
Well, it really wasn't a luxury, but all the savings, we had to look at code deficiencies first to make sure that those were all addressed, and they are still being addressed even with these reductions.
Now, the other one is with the PVC pipe, PVC pipe instead of cast iron,
right,
and that meets the code. Is that
yes,
correct?
It
Why was it put in the first place? It seems so PVC would be more economical than iron pipe originally.
It's $948 more economical.
Okay.
And did you should have gotten this list in your Friday supplemental packet.
I did, but I
them.
Didn't bring it with me tonight.
Okay.
So I have
yeah,
no
there's
idea.
A difference of $948.
Those are my concerns is about the fan and central air condition.
Councilor Coggeshall.
Am I, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Are we to, the final cuts were the second page that you sent us.
The $12,246.
Instead of the proposed possible savings, we're not to really look at that closely now. It's this new list?
That is the proposed list.
Okay.
So it would be the original bid amount minus $12,246.
Other questions? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've got a couple of questions on the proposed specific items to be cut or changed, actually. Number five lists change access gate to 2-inch galvanized pipe steel. Tell me which access gate we're talking about.
That was the emergency access gate near the Lunk School.
Mm-hmm.
That was proposed to be wooden. We are still maintaining that gate as it was originally proposed.
So it's just to be of a different physical material?
That's right.
Okay, thank you.
Excuse me, that cut is not one with an arrow going to it. That's going to be...
It's not a recommended cut.
Oh, that hasn't been cut. Oh, just the ones with the lines. We have to look at this again.
Councilor McLaughlin, do these lines follow Robert's Rules of Order?
Debbie, we would be so immersed following this one, we'd really be sunk. All right, then I've got one that is proposed to be changed. Now I have better understanding. Hey, number six, there's a line to number six. Change split face block to smooth face for savings of $51. Am I reading that correctly?
Mm-hmm.
I haven't looked at the plans to figure out where the smooth face versus split face is, but I think for aesthetics it might be worth keeping that in to the tune of $51. The original recommendation was to cut just over $10,000. We're now cutting over $12,000. I think we can afford $51 to have a building that's going to be a little more visually pleasing. So I'm not in favor of number six having a line to it. And that's the other thing I want to be sure of with this bid award is that we are getting a performance and payment bond.
Okay. Yeah, we're getting it not only on the contractor, but also any subcontractor over $10,000, which is something we have never done before.
I really appreciate your taking care of that. I know that Laca Construction is right now working on the Knox County Jail. From my sources, I understand they're doing a fine job there, but they haven't done a lot of large projects, is what I have found in conversations with people. But I'm comfortable with them, certainly, and very comfortable if we have those bonds. Thank you for that, attending to that. Thank you.
Okay, we don't have a motion yet. Is there a consensus of the council as to what we might want to do with item six on changing the split face block to smooth face? Councilor McLaughlin feels this would be a penny wise, pound foolish story to add that. Mm-hmm. Is there general feeling to eliminate that as a cut?
It's okay with me. Mm-hmm. Cut it.
Okay, let's.
Well, how do we know which one is more aesthetically pleasing?
If the split face is what was originally proposed, I think you can be well assured that that would be more aesthetically pleasing. If you look at the Shaw's Shopping Center, the new Shaw's building at Mill Creek, you'll see examples of split face and smooth face. It gives a three-dimensional quality to the outside of the building that you don't get with a smooth face.
The general feeling would be to, for $51, to go to the architect's first rendition.
Thank you.
Is there any argument about that?
I would say go to the original. Now, if the rest want to go against me,
that seems to be the general consensus of the council. So why do we not add that as an amendment, but just the town manager is aware that we will not have to take on that particular change. Other changes to the $12,100 and something now, or we'll have to figure a new delete total with that 51 factored in. Other issues?
I got a comment that probably I should have brought up sooner, that
this building project is going to end up over $400,000, which is what we earmarked for. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And the reason you're, the way you're doing it is taking some light winter leftover money to do it?
That's correct, as the memo that, explains.
Is that a fair statement?
That's correct.
The oil tank that's involved here is the one that's in the way of the project?
Yeah, it was
is that correct?
It was due for replacement. Right. The DEP was requiring it to be eliminated.
Yeah, but they're not pushing it now, but we got to do it because of it's interfered with the project, right?
Well, it needs to be replaced also per their regulations. It's over 25 years old.
I understand that, but they're a little lenient on that now.
Well,
so.
I don't know about that.
Well, it all depends who you want to talk to, I guess. Okay, I have no problems as long as it don't go over the $400,000.
Thank you. Other questions for Mr. Malley? Hearing none, I'll take a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we award the bid as presented this evening with the cuts, with the changes and credits as discussed this evening to Laca Construction.
Second.
For an amount not to exceed
of the $365,305 plus any plus or minus any change orders that may occur.
Did the clerk get that?
Within the contingency account.
Thank you.
$365,305
plus or minus change orders.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there further discussion on the issue? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Item 14 is to consider a report from the Board of Historic Preservation Advisors recommending improvements to the Spurwink Church and take any necessary action. Mr. Manager.
Yes, Jane Jordan, the Chairman of the Board of Historic Preservations, is here, as well as Ed Capano, who is still a member of the Board of Historic Preservation Advisors. Ed, the reason I hesitated, still a member, because many moons ago, Ed went out and got some estimates on some of the work that, that might be done. In looking through the estimates and in looking through the most recent memo from the board, I had to think it was board or a commission, I would think that initially, if the council authorized $12,000 out of the Spurwink Church Trust Fund to get started on this, we could get a major effort underway in painting the interior, the exterior, recarpeting the church, and making some other minor repairs. What I would propose, since these estimates are so old, is that we get new bids for the work from qualified contractors at the earliest possible date, and hopefully most of this work could take place just as soon as the church season is over. Jane is here to answer any questions you may have.
Mrs. Jordan, would you be kind enough to come down to the podium so that councilors may be able to ask you directly any questions with respect to this request? Councilors. Councilor Coggeshall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would just like to ask Mrs. Jordan if you have a priority listing of what you feel is the most important thing that needs to be done, and that will be what you do first, even if you don't have enough money to do the others.
Yes, we do. We would like to have the rug repaired or replaced, and probably any foundation work that might need to be done to it, because it does look like the building has shifted.
So essentially, it would be the foundation probably first?
First, yes. Except that there are, the holes in the rug are now getting somewhat dangerous, I think, for anybody that might have heels or so forth. I go over and cut them out every once in a while. So there aren't any rough edges there. The concern of Pat Capano, who is the church greeter, is that someone is going to trip and fall within that. But I did give the town manager a list of our priorities.
Okay, I didn't know if this really were prioritized. If you could remove the old carpeting and just use the old wooden floors this summer, Could you do that until you check your foundations?
I don't know what it looks like underneath, but there are some places where it's patched with plywood, but might be able to do just take the rug out. I'm not really sure what it all looks like underneath.
Other questions for Mrs. Jordan?
Yes. If I may, Mr. Chairman, I would like to see him go to work on the carpeting, because I was in the church recently, and I observed the carpet and a few things around there, and I would see some of these projects get started. But to me, the carpeting is number one, and I think it helps the acoustics a little bit if you have that carpet in there, too.
Mrs. Jordan, on item 14, there's an extra item dated 5/9/91 from your original list on the report back in November of 1990, in the sense that the pew should be examined and repaired as needed, is number 4 in the most recent item as prepared for us for the agenda. That apparently was not on the report of November of 1990. Have they deteriorated since that time, such that that is now a prioritized item?
No, I just felt that the inside of the church was more important than the outside of the church at this point.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
There is one pew in the back that is kind of, I don't know if it's a danger or anything, but it's separated from the back of the pew, the plank pews, and it's kind of separated.
Okay. So to continue Councillor Coggeshall's thought, then on our item 14 frontis page, the 8 items, that would be a prioritized desirability list, so to speak?
Yes.
Okay. Other questions or need for clarification? Councillor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As Councillor Coggeshall just noted, would you do painting after you installed new carpeting?
It could be done.
It can be done.
Yes. But the carpeting is not actually, it's just in the middle where the pews are. They had left an old carpet, I think it's 1920s, that it was installed. In order to keep some of the historic value of the church, they had left this old carpet in there, and now it's since worn. The carpet that is outside the pews, around the walls and so forth, is, I don't know when that was put in, 82 maybe. So it's fairly recent, and they've painted since then.
Okay, my concern would be more for the ceiling painting.
They have painted the ceiling since then.
Okay.
And
I appreciate hearing those comments. I'm also curious, there was a comment in one of the documents we received about minimal heating over the winter to keep the interior of the church more intact than if it's left to a colder temperature. I'm wondering, and you may not have this answer, it may be better directed to Mr. McGovern, about that being included in the budget for the church.
The problem is that the church is totally uninsulated. Yeah. And to heat it, you know, you'd be looking at thousands and thousands of dollars. There's the additional issue of you know, in an unoccupied building, in some respects, it's safer not to have the furnace going and, you know, possible fire, even though it is sprinkled. In some respects, it's more comfortable to have it there cold during the winter.
And that's fine with me. I'm certainly, none of us are going to vote to have oil bills flying out through uninsulated walls of the church. But I appreciate this discussion, so you will understand why we probably will not try to accommodate that part of the request.
That was one of the minimum things. And, okay. And I didn't realize that it wasn't insulated, although I should have.
Okay. Yeah, I'm very appreciative of your board for coming up with these requests. There is money available to do this, as I understand what's been presented in the information about the fund for the church. And again, it's a maintenance issue, which is something that I always like to be able to pay attention to, is the maintenance of our facilities so that we'll continue to have them in the good shape or better shape than they are right now. Thank you for the work you've done on this.
Thanks. Should have been done earlier.
Better late than never. At least we didn't have to walk in a roof to get this.
No, that's right.
Other questions for Mrs. Jordan?
Then I'll take a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we approve the expenditure of up to $12,000 from the fund, and I want to get the right name of it, the Spurwink Church Fund, Trust Fund, for the prioritized list of improvements that's been presented this evening.
Second motion.
Any discussion? Councilor Pearson.
Yes, Councilor Chairman. Councilor Chairman. There you go. Chairman Krillman. I just have a couple concerns that if there are problems perhaps with the foundation of the church that might be very costly, that we might want to, towards the future here, looking at some means of replenishing the church trust fund. Be it an ongoing type mailing to people that were married at the church. I know that it mentions that there was a Spurwink Church fund drive done, but I don't know how long ago that was. I imagine 83, so 8 or 10 years ago perhaps. But that might be a good thing to look into, to do on an annual basis, even for this project perhaps, to just send a mailing. We're thinking of restoring the interior of the church, et cetera, just to try to draw in some revenues. I think it might be for us to do that, to make sure that that fund balance does stay up there. Because if there is damage to the foundation that might require extensive work, you could easily deplete that based on the original estimates received. I think that's kind of close.
Your thoughts are so noted. I suspect the best approach would be to wait until we find out precisely what the foundation work will require, and then we can return to Carl's suggestion if necessary.
Yeah, we could. What I will do is contact a structural engineer and have him come look at the church. My fear is that we're going to get into a situation that a structural engineer wants perfection, and you may be looking at a major, major project.
If that's the case, then you would come back to us and we would have to reevaluate the expenditure.
If there is major structural work that needs to be done in the church, yes, because that would negate the ability to do a lot of the other projects on this list.
Mm-hmm. Any other discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. Thank you very much, Mrs. Jordan. Item number 15, to consider a report from the Planning Board recommending affordable housing zoning provisions and take any necessary action. Is there a representative from the Planning Board? Please. Mrs. McKay, would you tell people who you are and your address?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the Town Council. I'm Janet McKay, 9 Wood Road. I am not the chair of the Planning Board, but I did chair the Affordable Housing Subcommittee of the Planning Board this past year. I think you have before you a very able memorandum from our town planner dated May the 28th and a couple of page draft amendments to the affordable housing. The report of the Cape Elizabeth Affordable Housing Committee was published in February of 1989. Since that time, the Planning Board has been meeting a number of times to try to accomplish the task which we finally did in May when the amendments were recommended to you. I won't bother to go into the all of the developmental process, but I do want to stress for people, particularly at home, as well as here, that there really has been some, shall we say, evolution in the thinking of the Planning Board members. I think we've ended up in a place quite different from where perhaps some of us started. I would like to read, just for the record, the paragraph which states the purpose of the affordable housing amendments, and that is, the Planning Board finds that the housing shortage for persons of low and moderate income is detrimental to the public health, safety, and welfare, in that it discourages a community rich in economic, social, and cultural diversity. It is therefore a public purpose and an objective of the comprehensive plan to make available and integrate in the town an adequate supply of housing for persons of all economic segments of the community, including families, town personnel, and the offspring of residents. Very briefly, the Planning Board recommends that we adopt the state definitions of low and moderate income, that affordable housing be mandated with respect to 10% of new subdivisions in the town, that affordable housing units be geographically dispersed throughout the development, and that the units be compatible in their design with the other units in the development. There are legal requirements that mandate maintaining affordability. That's up to the developer at this point, but there are certain guidelines that the Planning Board has laid forth in the draft. And there would be in-lieu fees allowed in two circumstances. One, that the development itself contained less than 10 units. The second, in which there was either undue hardship or environmental conditions which did not make the inclusion of affordable housing units feasible. The intent was not to put this in perpetuity, but indeed to state that the provision would be evaluated for continued application within 5 years, so that we would have a chance to put this affordable housing concept into effect, but not try to cast it in stone at this particular point. I would be happy to try to answer any questions the councilors may have.
Councilor Coggeshall.
I do have a question on the lot size under section 19.3.17, under residency. The minimum lot size that's now allowed to be on the sewer, is that 8,000 or is it 10?
Does I Maureen? Know that the town planner is here tonight, and I'd like to ask her. I believe that it is 8,000, Maureen. Is that correct?
For the existing requirements in the RC zone, the minimum lot size is 20,000 square feet.
On a sewer?
That can be on or off a sewer. 20,000 square feet. As far as I'm aware, there's no distinguishing about whether or not you're on a sewer. If you have a non-conforming lot, there may be some opportunities for small lot sizes, depending on whether it's a grandfathered lot and it has sewer. The intent here was to allow this lower minimum lot size only if sewer was provided.
Okay, thank you.
I might add also that Maureen can supplement this, that the 8,000 square foot lot, I believe, was developed in part looking at the lot sizes for the standard lots in Elizabeth Park, among others. We were trying to figure out what might be a useful something as a building block rather than trying to take a number that we didn't know what the parameters were.
In that discussion, the board just thought about some of the neighborhoods in Cape Elizabeth that they felt represented what would be a good affordable neighborhood. Elizabeth Park was looked at, Brentwood was looked at, Oakhurst was looked at, and we looked at the maximum and the minimum lot sizes of those existing neighborhoods and what the averages were. And 8,000 tends to be right in the middle of the range of those neighborhoods. That's what the board is recommending right now.
Other clarifications with respect to the proposal. Please.
Just a comment. I was one of the council members, and I think Councilor McLaughlin and Councilor Coggeshall also, who were on the original Affordable Housing Committee that made the recommendations, I think some 2 years ago now. And I can't tell you how thrilled I am to get this recommendation from the Planning Board, because I think it takes the recommendations of that committee and improves upon them. And I'm really pleased to have this before us tonight. I want to commend the Planning Board for the work that you put in it and the town planner. And with that, I would like to move that we send these recommended affordable housing amendments to the Ordinance Committee for their perusal.
Second. Discussion.
the ordinance committee thanks you, Councilor Ammer. I, too, am very pleased to have this coming back in the format that I see it this evening. I'm sure we'll come up with some more refinements and such, as the ordinance committee is prone to do, and the council is prone to do. But I do thank the planning board and the planner for the work that's gone into this so far. Having served on that original committee, I know what, how, I want to say how deep the subject is. There is a lot of material to assimilate here and to come up with an ordinance that is reasonably going to suit Cape Elizabeth. Seems like we have an excellent start on that, and I, again, I thank you for the work.
Thank you.
Further discussion or thanks?
Just a comment that all I want to say is that when this originally started and the thinking around here as far as the planning board went, I never thought it would get this far, but I see new faces make changes, and I commend you for them.
I'd say ditto that. You asked for thanks, too, and thanks, because that's excellent.
Certainly carry this back to the planning board.
It truly is a joy to have it as far as it's come at this point. There is a motion on the floor to refer the item to the ordinance committee. May we have a vote on it? All affirmative? It's unanimous. Thank you. Thank you very much. Item number 16 is to consider a report from the ordinance committee regarding daycare zoning provisions and take any necessary action. And I will again refer this item 16 to our former chair of the ordinance committee, Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Old chairs don't go away very quickly sometimes. I can say this to the new chairman of the ordinance committee.
They just fade away.
And then they're the committee members. Mr. Chairman, in introducing the daycare zoning amendments, I want to express my thanks and the ordinance committee thanks to a number of groups and individuals who have helped get it to the place where it is right now. This was basically brought about because of concerns expressed by the Zoning Board of Appeals, who have been dealing with daycare situations. And it's my understanding that the proposals in this amendment incorporate a lot of the conditions that the Zoning Board of Appeals traditionally has been putting on daycare situations. I want to thank their staff member, Ernie McVane, for his input. I want to thank the Planning Board for taking these ordinance amendments and working through them, and also the town planner, who's had some very good input into these amendments. What is proposed at this point is amendments to the daycare zoning section of the ordinance, and these are intended to expedite the process of review for small daycare operations, which we now have a definition for. The definitions have been developed for both a daycare home and a day nursery, a daycare home being the larger of the two facilities, which would be a facility which provides a regular program of care and protection for 7 or more children under the age of 16, or any number of children in other than the operator's residence for any part of the day. The day nursery would be the smaller facility and is defined as a facility which provides a regular program of care and protection in the operator's residence for up to 6 children under the age of 16 for any part of the day. The amendments proposed before us this evening state that daycare for 6 or fewer children in the operator's residence, and this would be in the residential districts and in business district A, would not require review by the zoning board and the planning board if 4 conditions of operation are met. Instead, a use permit would be issued by the code enforcement officer. The conditions include the hours of operation, a fenced outdoor play area, limitation on outside play before 9 a.m. on weekends and holidays, and adequate lighting at the vehicle drop-off and pickup area, which, as I said, are typical conditions that the zoning board has been imposing on daycare operations as they've done their reviews. right now, with these proposals, the daycare operations for more than 6 children or daycare not provided in the operator's residence, which both fall under the daycare home, would continue to come under the existing process of zoning board and planning board review. We did have a discussion at ordinance committee level about setting a use permit fee. There is enabling language in the ordinance in section 19.4.4 that would allow the council to do that. I believe there may be a later motion made this evening to have the ordinance committee review some of the fees that are governed by the ordinance, and I would assume that's when a review of or installing a fee for a use permit for daycare operations could be discussed. And this is one that I think we can recommend be set to public hearing next month. I'm a little more on time with this one.
Thank you very much, Councillor McLaughlin. I do see our town planner, Ms. O'Mara, is with us still. Are there particular questions from the council with respect to the draft daycare amendments as put forth? Please, Councillor Cockeshall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. O'Mara, I just wanted to ask if for the daycare nursery, if the CEO issues a permit, are there other criteria that he uses to make sure it's safe as far as fire control and exits and everything else?
Yeah, and those would still continue, even if someone were to go through the process that we currently have, he would be doing those other types of reviews, building permit type reviews.
But he also does it with this shorter process.
Right, this shortened process wouldn't eliminate any of those other reviews. In addition, we usually get an updated list of who's operating daycare in the town every year when the state fire marshal comes down and does an inspection.
And you don't feel it's necessary to have that included in here?
No, there was some discussion at the ordinance committee level about additional types of review of regulation that ought to be incorporated. And I believe, without speaking for the councilors, that there was some agreement that the state regulates daycares rather stringently, and that the town may want to just focus in on the land use type portion of the regulation and allow the state to do the health type portion of the regulation. The one exception is the requirement that there be 75 square feet of play area per child in the daycare nurseries. That is a requirement under the state if you have more than 6 children, and that was added as a local regulation for up to 6 children.
Thank you.
Further discussion? I would entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we set to public hearing on Monday, July 8th, right. I believe it is, at 7:30, the proposed daycare zoning amendments as presented in our packet this evening, section 19-1-3 and section 19.2.2, section 19.2.4.
Second motion.
Thank you. I have a motion and a second. Further discussion on the daycare amendments? Seeing none, I'll take a vote. Those for the item? It is a unanimous vote. Thank you very much. Item 17, to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding amendments to the firearms ordinance and take any necessary action. I will refer this item again to our past chair of the Ordinance Committee, noting that our Chief of Police, Mr. Pickering, is in attendance, and I'm sure we'll be happy to clarify any issues after Councillor McLaughlin presents the firearms ordinance changes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I do certainly want to thank Chief Pickering for his work on the revisions that we're presenting this evening. We've brought this to the Ordinance Committee's attention based on a memo that Chief Pickering did December 89, and since then we've had another memo in mid-May from him where we have found that the state has preempted some of what we were hoping, at least the Chief is hoping, to see enacted a couple of years ago. And sometimes if we leave these things long enough, we don't have to deal with them. I also want to thank the town manager for his work on this and getting some of the language so it's more understandable to the layperson and helping out in that aspect. He's done his usual good job with that. What we are proposing is that we eliminate the current Article 1 that pertains to handgun control. This is because the state now, state statutes have preempted any town statutes for handgun control and from our doing regulation along those lines. Therefore, there is no need for Article 1. The current Article 2 would be renumbered Article 1. The discussion we had in Article 2, and this is talking about the discharge of firearms and specifically the killing of wildlife damaging crops. And I'll tell you, I've got a woodchuck at my house who's still quivering in his boots wanting to know how we're going to deal with this. They come in pairs, I've discovered, and they have a heart trap. Isn't always going to catch two of them at a time. What we are proposing is to eliminate the 12-hour notice period to the police department before a depredation activity could occur. There was discussion at the ordinance committee level about this and saying if you are choosing to deal with a wildlife predator with the use of a firearm, the 12-hour, is it 12-hour? Mm-hmm. The current 12-hour notice can inhibit your ability to carry out your intentions. That if you will at least call the police department, notify them that this is your intent, I do not know of an instance where they have disallowed that and have prohibited you from going forth. We just felt it was more sensible to delete the 12-hour recommendation. We have that discussion was based on very good input from the farmer on the ordinance committee who has much more experience with the wildlife damaging crops than hopefully the rest of us are ever going to have. But I do have a woodchuck for you. We are also recommending some minor semantic changes in what would be section 912. In addition, we are recommending that the penalty for violation be increased. The existing language states that the penalty for a violation would not exceed $100. Our recommendation is that it would not exceed $500. This is another proposed ordinance that we would recommend be set to public hearing at next month's meeting. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Councillor McLaughlin. Chief Pickering, would you be kind enough to come to the podium as there may be some specific questions or need for clarification from members of the council? Chief is here at your beck and call. Any? Please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chief Pickering, should we perhaps clarify for the public the criteria needed for a depredation permit?
Yes, there has to be a visible crop damage. We always involve the Maine Warden Service, and actually they are the ones that issue the permit. The only thing we do is to satisfy the ordinance that we have been notified and to keep control of the number of discharges and the number of game animals that are taken or animals that are taken. So the state is involved in this process from the start. We haven't had any particular problem, and oddly enough, as many times as this ordinance has been put in effect, we have very few complaints about it. So it has worked pretty well. The other thing I might add is that the state statute, which Councilor McLaughlin referred to, is called the preemption law. And basically what that says is that no municipality may enact a ordinance which is more restrictive than state statute. So with that, we lost not only the waiting period, but also all these other handgun control statutes and ordinances. So until that is repealed, which doesn't look like it's going to be handy in the future, we're stuck with that.
Thank you.
Other questions from the council? Council Randall.
I don't think this one's for the chief, but for the audience committee. What was the reasoning behind increasing the fine from $100 to $500? That's a pretty huge increase.
It can be a pretty huge violation, too, I think, going along with that. The $100 amount has been in effect since 1976. And we thought that just to reflect the change in times and the severity of the type of violation you could have, that 500 was much more in keeping with what we wanted to see.
I think the discussion also was that it is a not to exceed clause, so that it does give the judge the leeway to go up to that amount, but does not necessarily mean that a judge would levy that amount.
It's been our experience that they've been fairly conservative in issuing those types of fines as well.
Other input, questions, clarifications? Councilor Jordan.
Yes, Chief. It's a feeling that the Great Pond is under federal regulations.
Well, as is any area, we allow discharge of firearms here because it's technically below the last aqua vegetation, similar below the last the high water mark. So that historically has been used for hunting and will continue to be so.
Yeah, I understand that, but I was reading this and it doesn't mention that you're allowed to do it in the Great Pond.
I didn't hear
that. It doesn't mention the Great Pond. It mentioned under federal regulations.
I think that was in the original ordinance, wasn't it? I believe it was something like that.
That's right.
Should still be in the ordinance.
It should continue to be that way and not change.
I'm not sure if it takes a specific provision to allow the discharge down there or not. It has been there, and we probably should enjoy that piece of the ordinance if it's still available to us. But I don't believe we have jurisdiction on that waterway as it is over 10 acres.
Okay.
So it technically comes under state and federal jurisdiction both.
Do we want to say property under state and federal jurisdiction here rather than just in federal jurisdiction?
That was going to be one of my brainstorms at a committee meeting.
I hate to steal your storm.
It would be good to clear that up, don't you think?
It might be good to keep that original language in there.
The original language is still there.
We have the original still. Mm-hmm.
Given that that language still exists in the original copy, I think we're
it
satisfied.
It hasn't been changed.
Should be.
So we should be okay.
Should be right.
Other input? I'll take a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we set to public hearing on Monday, July 8th at 7:30, the proposed Chapter 9 firearms section of the ordinance, as presented this evening, with Article 1, Discharge of Firearms, Section 911, Prohibition of Discharge of Firearms, Section 912, Killing Wildlife Damaging Crops, and Section 913, Penalty.
Second motion.
Further discussion? All those in favor? 7-0 vote. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Chief Pickering. Item number 18 is to consider a report from the town manager regarding sewer billing for homes with wells and take any necessary action. Mr. Manager.
Currently, the very few homes we have that are on sewer that do not have public water service, we give a sewer bill of the minimum quarterly amount. It only seems fair that they be billed a usage charge as some others are. Recently, the Portland Water District has changed their policy whereby they will do sewer billing for homes without water service, and I would like to propose that you send to the Ordinance Committee an amendment that would accomplish the review of this issue.
Thank you very much. Just for anyone who may be listening, what the sub-meter that would be installed at the expense of the property owner, my understanding is that the cost of that sub-meter would be in the ballpark of about $100. I will take a motion on this particular item.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we refer to the Ordinance Committee the proposed language dealing with submeters for wells.
Second? Thank you. Discussion, please.
Move the question.
Hearing no discussion and moving the question, all those in favor? 7-0. Thank you very much. Item number 19 is to consider establishing a town center planning committee and take any necessary action. I alluded to this particular item earlier on this evening in my comments with respect to the upcoming year. What we are proposing in item 19 this evening is to establish a Cape Elizabeth Town Center planning committee. The establishment of the committee would be for the purpose of creating a planning committee for Cape Elizabeth, looking at the issue of the town center. This planning committee would consist of 9 citizens appointed by the town council. Of the 9 members, 2 of the members would be members of the town council, recommended by the town council chairman. The Cape Elizabeth School Board and the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board shall each designate 1 member on the committee, a former member of the Main Street 90 Committee Town Center Subcommittee would be added, 1 business owner, 1 resident of the town center area, and 2 citizens from the community at large shall be recommended by the Town Council Appointments Committee. The chairman of the committee shall be designated by the town council, and the secretary of the committee shall be chosen by the committee at its first meeting. The committee charge would be the following 6 items. Number 1, define the town center, quote unquote, an area no later than November 1st, 1991. Number 2, review the desirability of recommending interim setback requirements for the town center, again by November 1st, 1991. Number 3, prepare a preliminary vision of the town center by November 1st, 1991. Number 4, follow the attached draft outline of the work required to develop a town center plan for Cape Elizabeth. Number 5, provide quarterly progress reports to the town council. And lastly, number 6, present a recommended town center plan to the town council no later than December 31st, 1992. As indicated with number 4, following the attached draft outline of work required to develop a town center plan for Cape Elizabeth, I will not go into the extensive and detailed preparation that our town planner has offered us in this regard, but we do have available a 5-sectioned town center plan draft outline for the purposes of this Cape Elizabeth town.